I gotta share a story with you guys before we start. So I was around 18, 19, 20. I would not be able to wake up in the morning. I would lay in bed for 2 to 3 hours, just lay there and contemplate my entire life. Why am I alive? What's my purpose? Who am I? All these questions of who was I? And when you ask the wrong question, you'll receive the wrong answer. Instead of asking, who am I? I should have just asked, who do I want to create? Let's create me. Let's create the version of me, because we evolve every day. We change every day. So if you're in the loop of trying to find yourself, you're going to find yourself, but then you change the day after, you change the year after. So you continue to freaking try to find yourself for the rest of your life. You will never find yourself. But what you will do is create yourself. If you create yourself, you're creating this version of you, but then you evolve, you read this new book, you gain this new awareness. So then you keep creating. You're creating this new version. You're always creating the best version of who you are. Finding yourself, I think, is the wrong question. I think that's a big problem on why a lot of individuals, a lot of people are having the problem discovering who they are. We create ourselves. Anyway, so when I was 18, 19, 20, couldn't wake up, take 2-3 hours to wake up. And then when I was going to bed, I'd take 2-3 hours to fall asleep. I'd go to bed at 11, 12. I just had the very poor sleeping pattern. And this resulted in me not wanting to be on earth anymore. I would question that. Like, and I feel for a lot of people who have to question themselves on why are they alive, why are this? Because I've been down that path. I was on that path for 3-4 years, addicted to drugs and all this kind of stuff. And the biggest change was adding one thing, a new habit, the year after a new habit. And it took me 3-4 years, but I kept adding these habits, very simple habits, but I'd stay consistent. Key thing, stay consistent. If you can stay consistent with a habit or stay consistent with a routine or behaviors, it'll compound. And then you add another one. And next thing you know, a couple years pass, and you have these key habits that I'm going to show you today that change your entire life. And you look back, and this is where the aha moment was. I think I was 24, 25, and I looked back and I was like, wow, I'm not struggling with mental health like I used to struggle with. My low days are not low anymore. My low days are just days where I look back and I'm like, what can I learn from this day? What lesson are you trying to teach me? And then the low day would pass. I'd wake up motivated, inspired. I would fall asleep within 5 minutes. I would wake up within 5 minutes. It was just, everything changed. And I get these questions a lot on my social media, because what I want to do is I want to help people and create that vessel to help them heal. And this is one of the most popular questions is, hey, how can I overcome stress? How can I overcome anxiety? How can I overcome laziness, mental health? And that's why I'm creating this video, is for these exact questions. These 7 days are going to propel you to be the person you want to become, to be extraordinary, to be the best version of yourself. So again, so excited about this vlog format, the style I'm going to show you guys. Let's dig into day one. We'll talk soon. Much love. And the way I'd recommend you do these 7 days, I'd watch this entire video, understand, have the awareness around what these 7 days are, and then what you do now is you start with day one, and you add that habit, that routine to your day one. You move things around, you remove a bad habit, remove any barriers that are in the way, add this thing to it. Now, day two, you would go back to this video, fast forward it to day two, grab that day two, and do just that day two. Day three, fast forward to day three, just do day three. And every day, you add that habit or add that routine or add that thing to your day, and you remove something else. And you do this for 7 days. And then once you do it for 7 days, repeat this for the entire year. Not the video. Don't repeat the video. The video is done. But these 7 things that you've added to your routine, to your habits, just do this for 1 straight year. It's not going to be hard. It'll take less than 5 minutes a day for each of these things to just add them in, and you will notice such a massive shift. So the way I did this video is I did it in like a vlog format. So I'm going to record my entire day. I'm going to record from waking up till I go to bed. And I'm going to record these 7 things, because I've had these things in my life, in my routines for the last, I don't even know, 5+ years. Like, I've added, taken some out, added, taken some out. And these are the 7 things that have stuck around the longest and I've made the most impact. And I would say 80% of my mental, overall physical well-being is because of these 7 things. Okay? Super stoked. Again, I'll share a bonus at the end. Let's do this. So excited. Thank you for coming. Okay, welcome to the first vlog style video of mine. This seems like a lot more fun and I'm enjoying this. It's a fun process. I just woke up about a half hour ago and I thought it'd be a perfect segue into the first thing about increasing and improving your mental well-being and just getting rid of mental health and just taking control of your life and your mind. And the first thing, as you may have guessed, is sleeping. There's nothing more important than sleeping. That is the root, the pinnacle to everything. If your sleeping is off balance, your entire well-being will be off balance. It's as simple as the circadian rhythm. And now, a circadian rhythm, it's this little pineal gland in the back of your mind, back of your brain, and it releases serotonin and melatonin. Okay, so serotonin, let's just call it the happy chemical. Melatonin, let's call it the sleepy chemical. So what it does in the evening, it naturally releases a little bit. When the sun goes down and it starts to get dark, it naturally releases some. And you start to fall asleep. But here's the catch. If you're off balance, it doesn't know when to release the melatonin. If there's always a screen in front of your eyes, so a phone or a TV, and there's blue light, that kills melatonin. So you're preventing your brain from naturally producing melatonin. And this is not good. This will affect mental well-being and mental health and all that stuff. So if your night is off balance, your circadian rhythm will be off balance. If you're not following the sun, your circadian rhythm will be off balance. Now, in the morning, serotonin. Serotonin is released naturally by the circadian rhythm. The sun wakes up, the brain starts to produce serotonin, releases it. You start to feel more energized, motivated, inspired, whatever feeling. But again, if your circadian rhythm is off balance, your internal mind clock, your internal clock inside your head is off balance. It's not releasing at the proper times, or it's not releasing any because of the systems that you've set in place. So it's really important to lock in your sleep. Now, some tips to lock in your sleep. Get consistency. Consistency will help your circadian rhythm rebalance. The other thing is environment. So if there's any noises, if it's your partner, if it's a dog, an animal, it's important that you lock in your sleep. Because if you lock in your sleep, you wake up in the morning refreshed, energized, happy. And now you can be the best version of yourself for your partner, the best version of yourself for your dog, the best version of yourself for your cat, whatever animal you have. You can be the best version of yourself for yourself and then for the others around you. So if your sleep, it keeps getting interrupted, and now you've gotten used to having poor sleep, it just affects everything in your life, including your mental health. Sleep is the most important thing. Blue light, phones, TVs, they need to be shut off 2 hours before bed, at least. Now, if you can't shut off your phone and if you're not going to let yourself shut off the TV, then get some blue blockers. Throw on some goggles, throw on some glasses. When I read at night, so I shut everything off, all my blue light at 7, and the only blue light I have is from my iPad, which I've shut off the blue light from the iPad itself. There's an app that you can get, and I just put on my blue blocker, so it blocks off the blue light. So I read before bed. That's my way of decompressing and allowing the circadian rhythm to slow down and allowing the melatonin to be released. And that's my system, and I've trained my body to do that. In the morning, I wake up. As soon as the sun wakes up, I wake up. No alarm clock. When the sun wakes up, I wake up. That's my system. A lot of people are like, oh, 5 a.m. club, 5 a.m. club, blah, blah. That's cool. If it works for you, try it. If it works, fantastic. Didn't work for me. I tried it for a few months. Didn't like it. I'm a sun person. Sun wakes up, I wake up. When it's winter, cool. I wake up a bit later. That's just the way my body is. And I think that's the way everybody's body's in. Come here, I'll tell you a secret. Everybody's body is from the nature, from the universe. So therefore, follow the sun, follow nature.
All right, welcome to day 2. So day 2, very important one, food. This is not gonna be a food lesson or a nutritionist lesson. That's not what this is. I'm simply sharing my experience on what I experienced, what I've been through, in my journey with food, but a few key things. Food, your body is your temple. So if your body is your temple, what are you consuming? Gut-brain connection. The gut connects to the brain. Back in evolution, in the early days, our gut used to be our primary brain. It would guide us towards food. It would tell us where the food is. It would help us to eat. This was here because this wasn't developed yet. That's why you hear sometimes, oh, I have this gut instinct, I have this gut feeling, or you feel something here, your intuition, you feel like something's here. It's your primary brain. But now, because of the development here, the neocortex, skull has expanded, all that stuff, this has now turned to our primary brain. This is our secondary brain. It hasn't gone anywhere. It's still there. There's still so much knowledge and wisdom in here. And we can tap into that. Now, what you put inside of your gut creates an effect in what you put in your brain because it's still connected. They still talk to each other every single day. So if they talk to each other and you're putting bad stuff here, you're transmitting bad stuff up here. And I think that is one of the biggest causes of mental health, diseases, and stress and anxiety and all that is because of what we put inside our stomachs. Now, in terms of food, what I recommend you stay away from sugars, extremely bad for you. Stay away from anything very processed, right? Processed salt. Stay away from like any fast food chain. Highly, highly recommend you stay away from like McDonald's and all that stuff. Like that stuff is killing you. The antibiotics and the steroids and these animals are pumping inside of you. You're eating stress. You're eating harm. You're eating all this pain that the animal, you're eating this stuff. What do you think that's going to signal to your brain? It's going to signal harmful pain. It's going to signal bad stuff. So again, take care of your microbiome. That's what's in here, your microbiome. Another thing to look into, dairy. Dairy is also very bad, pumped with all these antibiotics and all these steroids and all this kind of stuff. This goes into here, goes to your brain, goes to the rest of your body. Your body is your temple. So be careful what you put inside your body. We're not living 100, 200, 300 years ago. It's not like before where we had the animals in our backyard. It's not like that. It is highly processed. It is highly over, I don't even know what the word is, but it's just like, it's just not done properly. The system is broken and it's breaking you. Please take care of you, okay? Now, a few other key things. What you do wanna do, hit the legumes, hit the vegetables, hit the fruits, hit the things that have come from earth, that earth pushes out of earth, right? Now, I'm gonna share a quick little story. This is not a food lesson. This is not a preach, this is nothing. You have to do what works for you. You have to test it out. Do you? I did me in 2000, when I was 22, I did me. Struggling with mental health. I've shared those stories before. Sorry, it took me 2 hours to fall asleep, 2 hours to wake up. Everything was off balance. I was eating so much food, processed food, so much meat, so many things in cereal boxes, and I was eating breakfast, and I was eating so much stuff. And I read a book about happiness and how the happiest people in the world are vegetarian. And I said, this is interesting. And then I kept reading, a lot of philosophers are vegetarian. And then I kept reading, a lot of polymaths are vegetarian, like Albert Einstein and all this stuff, like the smartest people. So like, why? Why is there, what's the overlap here? What am I missing? So I tried it. I went vegan. I said, screw it. Why not give it a shot? Remove all the biases, remove all the information, like just trust yourself. So when I went vegan, everything changed within 2 weeks. My asthma left. I had no more asthma. My eczema, gone. Now I just get it for like 2-3 weeks during the winter when it's very, very dry. But I used to have it all year round. Gone. Everything left. And it blew my mind. I was like, what? Because of what I'm putting inside my body? And next thing you know, a couple weeks pass, my mental clarity. I started to have a vision and goals and dreams and ambition, confidence. I started to get all these things because of my lifestyle choice of food. And ever since then, I've been very passionate about what I put inside my body. Organic, no pesticide, no GMOs. Like, I stay away. Like, it's just getting deeper and deeper. But again, you don't have to do what I'm doing. Do what works for you. This is step one in just understanding what food means to you, right? Start taking out sugar. Start taking out processed food. Stop drinking juices and pops that's full of sugar. Like, stop that stuff. Do the organic, natural stuff from earth. Vegetables and all that kind of stuff that I was saying. A few quick tips before we end this. Stay away from alcohol. I know this is very controversial because people love their alcohol because it helps them escape their pain and their suffering. And I get it. I was there. I was an alcoholic. I would drink 26ers every single weekend. I'd pound gin back. I drank so much beer, and that's when I was at my lowest, and it helped me at the time, but it no longer served me because I was going down a bad path. That's me. It's poison for the liver, kidneys, and body. It's poison for the inside. It's poison for the brain. It's poison for everything. There's no beneficial, zero benefits. Just a recommendation, stay away from alcohol. The other thing is look into intermittent fasting. Intermittent fasting is a very interesting concept. I adapted it about a year ago, and it really did help in a lot of different areas. I noticed it increased my clarity, it increased my focus, it increased about 20% of my energy in my day. So around 5-6 o'clock, I used to get tired. Now it's around 7-8 o'clock. I noticed a 20% increase because I stopped eating breakfast. I only eat lunch and dinner. Now my lunch and dinner are bigger meals. I get my calorie intake. I get all my minerals, all my protein. I make sure all my carbs, I make sure everything is in that dish. I eat at 12 and eat at 5. For 18 hours, you don't eat. So I stop at 5 and I don't eat. This helps with my sleep, drastically helps. It also helps when I wake up in the morning. And the reason why it helps with my sleep is because now my microbiome is done at 5-6 o'clock. These guys inside can clock out. They're done work. They don't have to keep working and working and trying to digest. They can rest. In the morning, I drink water, a full thing of water. And now I slowly wake them up they're waking up, they're getting ready for the day. And then at 12 o'clock, I start to eat and they start to go. Now imagine we eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner, which we're programmed to do just about 100 years ago. So we're eating all this food, and right as soon as we wake up, these guys have to wake up. And it takes 3 hours to digest, and then lunch, keep going. Dinner, keep going. Think about everything that's going on inside. Eventually, inflammation, diabetes, leaky gut, all these things start to happen because we're overworking these guys inside here. So once you take out breakfast, it massively changes the energy, because now instead of putting all the energy into your gut trying to digest, you're now putting the energy inside you into what you want to do. Again, it takes time. It took me about 4 to 6 weeks to get adapted to it, but our bodies are very quick to adapt in good and in bad. Thousands and thousands of years, in hunter-gatherer days, even 200 years ago, we wouldn't eat for a long time. Right? We had to hunt for our food, find our food, take time to eat, and all that stuff. So we're used to it. We can do it. So look into fasting. See if it works for you. Give it a shot. If you notice a massive intake in your energy, keep it. If it doesn't work for you, then don't do it, but pretty confident it will. And then there's a 24-hour fast and a 5-day fast. So I do intermittent fasting every day. Once a month, I'll do 24 hours. Once a year, I'll do 5 days. The reason I do that, I read a study about longevity. It helps keep your body in pristine condition inside. It helps kill zombie cells. Zombie cells are cells die and come alive. Sometimes the zombie cells don't, they just stay there. And then that turns into a cancer cell. You don't want it to turn into a cancer cell. When you do longer periods of fasting, you're killing your zombie cells. Again, there's a whole book called Longevity about this. So we're not gonna dig into it. I'm just saying, do your personal research on fasting. Just a quick tip about that. See you at day 3 right now.
Welcome to day 3. Now, we're gonna talk about self-love. It's the relationship with yourself. This is so important along your journey of healing yourself and becoming the person you want to become. Is the first steps is you want to love yourself, because everything you think becomes. So if you think something is good, it will be good. If you think something is bad, it will be bad. Nothing is either good or bad. It's your thoughts that make it so. That's a quote by, I think, Waldo. I'll add it, but it's such a powerful quote, and it's so true. You hear it all the time. And I am living proof of that quote. When I was in a very bad spot, I was playing victim. I was victim to everything. It was everybody's fault, my parents' fault, everybody's fault. I never took accountability. And I couldn't take accountability because I didn't love myself. I didn't have confidence. I was struggling inside. And once I just took accountability, and once I started to love myself, and I'll share all those tools soon, everything started to open up. Everything started to change. I wasn't blaming anybody. I took accountability. It was the past. The past is done. What is today? What is the future? And how can I be the best version of myself today, right now? Because that's all that matters, is today. And when you change that mindset and you become in love with yourself and you develop that confidence, develop of who you are, it continues to evolve, and you notice everything starts to change. And like I said, the next 4 days will all be about how to self-love and how to do all that. So the tools are coming for that. And a few key things I want to mark here, just So you have the awareness is the inward and outward journey. The inward journey is all inside. The outward journey is everything outside, material and stuff like that, and other people and other environments. You can control your inward. You cannot control your outward. So if you focus on the in, you heal the in, you be with the inward, and you love yourself, you trust your intuition, your gut, your soul comes out to speak, that's when all changes for you. Once the inward is healed, the outward heals, because the inward, your perception, your awareness, the way you see the world, everything starts to change and it becomes beautiful. And you start to appreciate everything, the past and everything. But again, you focus on the present. So inward and outward journey, I recommend look inward. Your answers are not out there. Your answers are not on social media. Your answers are not in friends or family. Your answers are all inside. Your answers are not in your partner. Your answers are in here. So inward's big. Highly recommend that one. The other thing I'd mention is accepting yourself. Accept you. Accept who you are. You're beautiful. You're important. You mean everything to everybody. You are a soul being. You have so much to give and so much to share, and you have so much power within. We all have the same powers. We all have it here inside of us, our heart, our soul, our being. So accept yourself. Accept your situation. Accept what is given to you. It's a mindset shift to accept yourself, but it's something that can go very, very far, and it's very powerful. The last thing I'll leave you with the relationship with self is to understand what deprogramming and reprogramming means. I think it's very powerful to deprogram the mind of old behaviors, old habitual patterns from what the school installed in us, from what our parents installed in us, from what politics, government, countries, cultures. It's important to keep what aligns with you, right? Cultures are so rich and important. And I'm not saying you take that off. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, look what's inside. Look what means well to you. What does it mean to you? Does it connect with you? If you're not questioning it, then that means it connects with you and you keep that. But now when you deprogram all the false beliefs and everything that has been programmed in your subconscious, you start from scratch, carte blanche. You're brand new, you're fresh. And now you reprogram it the way you want it, the way you believe, the way that you feel that is right. And that's where we'll talk about tools later on how to reprogram the subconscious mind. Once you reprogram this and you start to believe how deep you can go and how much you can do, the whole world changes. You are the creator of your destiny, of your life. No one will create it for you. You will. Anyways, it's getting long again. I gotta stop getting on these rants, but you get the point. Let's hop over to, what is it? Day four next? Let's hop over to day four. Talk soon. Didn't see you there. Day six is reading. Reading is a tool that can be added to your journey, to your path, that will increase your IQ. It'll increase your EQ. IQ is intellectual intelligence. EQ is emotional intelligence. It's where you're bridging knowledge and wisdom together. And this can bring you to a whole other world, because what it does, it expands your mind. And a mind once expanded cannot shrink to its old mind. So the more you open up your mind by learning new things that align with you, that connect with you, the more you start to see the world differently in the way that you see how you want to see it, in the way you perceive it. And I've been reading, I think I've read over 150 books, and I never read till after the age of 22. And I made a whole video about this. I'll add it in the notes, or I'll pop it up on the screen or something. But there's a whole video about the top five books I recommend and my journey of reading and that stuff. So I won't get too deep into that. But basically, reading is a cornerstone. Again, it helped me with my awareness. It helped me to reprogram my mind. And it allowed me to find my happiness, because it allowed me to discover my interest, what I didn't like, what I did like, what aligned with me, what didn't align with me, to then create the version I want to create. Because in these books, we're able to grab 40 to 50 to 60 years of wisdom that somebody spent their entire life discovering and figuring it out to write it on in a book, and we have access to that book, and we're able to read what's in that book. And I think that is the most powerful thing ever. Again, you need to have a filter system. You can't believe everything you read and everything you study. You have to believe what aligns with you. And if it aligns with you and it makes sense to you, then great, believe it. Don't let anybody tell you if it's right or wrong, right? I'm in love with quantum physics and self-development and spirituality and energies and frequencies. And I tell some of my friends and family, I stopped telling them now, but I used to tell them, and they look at me like, what kind of voodoo stuff are you doing? What kind of stuff are you talking about? And they look at me weird, which would then discourage me. So now I just don't even bother talking about it. That's why I started this YouTube channel, so I can talk about it on here. But fall in love with what aligns with you. That's all that matters. And that will bring you the joy and the happiness. But reading is very powerful. A quick tip on how to add reading to your day. Keep it simple. 10 to 15 minutes a day. That's all you need. And you'll be able to do 1 to 2 books a week. Sorry, 1 book every 1 or 2 weeks. Whoa, that's a lot. 1 to 2 books a week. I haven't gone there. I read 10 to 15 minutes as soon as I wake up. So in my morning, I drink my water, I do my journaling, I meditate, I yoga, and then I read for 10 minutes. That's it. Nighttime, I read 15 to 30 minutes before bed. That's it. I'll read a chapter to 2 chapters a day max, but I usually aim for 1 chapter a day because usually books have about around 10 chapters. So in 10 days, I'm done the book and then I add the next book. And I don't read to read. I underline because I have a Kindle, and I keep those notes and I take notes and I engage with the stuff, and then I teach the stuff, which allows me to learn more. Anyways, read. I highly recommend it. You will love it. It's so powerful. All right, let's head to day 6. All right, welcome to day 6, meditation and mindfulness practice. Now, this is another tool that if you add to your tool belt, and you add to your journey on life, it will increase your happiness, your joy, your self-love, your confidence, your gratitude. There is, unfortunately, no side effects to a meditative practice. And it's been shown for thousands of years now that it is a tool that brings so much joy and happiness and clarity, mind clarity. So for me, meditation, I added this into my practice at about 22, 23 years old. The hardest thing of my life, even to this day. So it's been about 8 years. Even to this day, my thoughts don't stop. They still come up. They do not stop. But that's the point. They never stop. What the beauty is of all this meditation, now I'm able to realize where the thoughts come from. Do they come from past fears? Do they come from false beliefs? Do they come from a place of love, from intuition, from the soul? Does it come from the ego? Right, so now I'm able to understand my thoughts and where they come from. So when I'm sitting down and I'm doing my meditation, I'm able to see with clarity on where these thoughts are from, what to put energy on and what not to. Because your thoughts are like a garden. So you put these seeds in the garden and then the weeds come out. You keep watering them. The seeds turn into flowers. The weeds keep coming out. But you take out the weeds. You pluck them out. You don't put energy into those weeds. You take them out. They're no longer there in your garden. And you continue to water the plants and you continue to water the flowers and they continue to grow. The point is, water the seeds that you want. Stop watering the seeds that you don't want. A negative thought, thoughts from the ego, thoughts from the past, fear, leave those. Stop watering them. They will go away. They'll come up for a second, they leave. They come up, they leave. And then the other thoughts, the positive ones, you keep watering them, you act on them, you actions. Right? You meet your meditation practice with actions. And that's what meditation has been for me, has allowed me to see what thoughts to put energy and what thoughts not to put energy. So that's the point of meditation, okay? I'll share some quick tips. Meditation is like increasing your consciousness and decreasing your unconscious mind. They say, according to Dr. Dispenza, and I really do believe this, we are about 95% unconscious. So our subconscious mind is running our lives. It's when we're driving, it's like we don't really process. We're just subconsciously driving. And our subconscious mind is our wants, our needs, our fears, our desires, everything is in our subconscious mind. So if we program our subconscious mind the way we want it and not the way that society wants it, a lot changes as well. So when you meditate,
You're very present and you're very still and you're very conscious. And you're 95% subconscious and you're 5% conscious. When you meditate, you change the levels. So you decrease the subconscious and you increase the conscious. And the more you do that, the more practice, the more conscious you are. Because a conscious mind, a conscious being, is a very present being. They are there, they are now. When they are driving and they have no thoughts. That is consciousness, that is full mindful. When you're eating, you eat a piece of broccoli, you taste the broccoli, you feel the broccoli, you're only with the broccoli. When you're doing any task and you're only doing that one task, that is mindful consumption, that is mindfulness, that is meditative, right? So there's so many different meditative practices. So one of them is meditation, right? Where you concentrate on the breath, in, out, a thought comes up, you let it go, right? That's a tip. So when you're meditating, thoughts don't stop. They come, you take the tip or the, you take the, whatever comes up, whatever thought, you let it go. Come back to your breath. In, out, in, oh, another thought. Let it go, right? I'm not putting energy on it. Let it go. And then come back to your breath, right? You do that. And eventually with time, second meditation, third meditation, a month passes by, your thoughts take a bit longer to enter the mind. So now you've not to steal the mind. And now you have control over the mind. The mind doesn't have control over you. They call it the monkey mind. You control the monkey won't control you. So that's one big tip. The other thing is, look what works for you. There's visualization meditations. Those are type of meditations that you go on YouTube, type visualization. I like Bob Proctor. He does like a very good abundance meditation. So abundance meditation, Bob Proctor, and he talks about how to be abundant. And he talks for about 20, 30 minutes. But now you're only focusing on that one thing. You're just focusing on his voice. That's it. And that's a meditative practice. Like I said, the one with the breath, eating. If you just focus on eating for 5 minutes, meditative practice. When you're walking, focus strictly on your legs hitting the ground or that one tree in front of you and just walk to that tree. Meditative practice. So you'll notice eventually the more you do this, the more you've been meditating your entire life. But now you're just aware of it. Now you're just mindful about it. And this is where the evolution changes. This is where you increase your EQ. Emotional intelligence. You increase your wisdom because now you're reflecting on your thoughts. You're reflecting on what's good, what's bad, what the lesson is from that bad experience, or what's the lesson? You've turned it into a good thought. Anyways, very passionate about meditation. Doing it for such a long time. Highly recommend you look into it. If you have any questions about meditation, please reach out to me. I love meditation, my favorite topic, and we'll talk soon. Much love. Oh, wait. We will talk soon because I'm not leaving anywhere. We're going to day 7. See you day 7. Ciao. I don't know why I keep saying ciao. It's literally happening right after this clip.
All right, welcome to day 7. I'm super stoked because after day 7, we have a bonus, which you're gonna love the bonus. It's gonna be like, oh, sweet. So bonus coming right up. Day 7, I'm gonna keep it nice and sweet. The reason I'm gonna keep it nice and sweet is because just last week, I posted a video about this exact topic. So if you really want to dig deep in this topic, check out that link. Check out the video I'll put in the show notes. But quickly, social media consumption. This is very important because we talked earlier about subconscious mind and conscious mind. You are programming your subconscious mind every day if you know it or not. Awareness is key around this topic. Programming the subconscious mind. When you're reading, consuming music, podcast, TV, book, media, anything, you're programming the subconscious mind. So who do you want to become? You understand that person, you understand their blueprint, and you consume what they consume, consume what they do, and you'll become that person. It's that simple of a blueprint. But this is where the caveat, this is where it gets scary. Social media. If we're not mindful of what we're consuming, and we're consuming all these accounts, and we're just consuming, 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 we're programming our mind with all these beliefs, false beliefs, identities that are not us. So if you follow 1,000 people and you consume, you know, let's say 50 of those people that you actually like deeply consume, and they have these cars and they have these watches and they have this material stuff, these houses, or they're traveling, or they have this girlfriend, that boyfriend, they're on their third girlfriend, their third boyfriend, their fourth divorce, their first divorce. You're consuming all this stuff. You're programming your subconscious mind saying that that's okay, right? So if relationships don't succeed, it's sometimes because of social media, We think that everything is possible because of social media. Someone is traveling, we have like, why am I not traveling? We compare our chapter 2 to somebody's chapter 20. And that's a massive tip here. Never compare your chapter 2 to someone's chapter 20. And that's the problem with social media. We don't see the full curtain, right? We only see what they want us to see. So we see only the good most of the time. 99% of the time, we only see the good. We don't see the 10-year struggle to get there. We don't see the day-to-day mental health and the day-to-day struggle that they're having, and they're faking it, right? And not everyone does that, but a lot are, right? You only see the beauty stuff. And that's why, like, my key thing is when I'm doing this, I want to be very authentic, right? And more creators are being more authentic, but that's not the point. Everybody is trying to figure it out. I'm still figuring it out. Everybody you meet is figuring out if they say it or not. They're figuring it out because we don't really know anything. So if you're consuming these 50 people are trying to figure it out, and they're evolving, they're being themselves, they're trying to change, they're trying to upgrade, they're trying to get blah, blah, blah. And then, but you're consuming their stuff thinking, oh, that's that. Right? So social media, mindful consumption is very important. If you want some tips from me, I recommend you remove everything and everybody. I recommend you follow 3 to 5 accounts max that do not make you feel fear, that do not make you feel like, oh, I wish I was them. You're not stuck in the comparison loop. Accounts that actually, you look at their video and you're like, cool. You put your phone down and you act on something, you actionize, go to the gym, you feel motivated, inspired to eat healthier, to be better, to just whatever is positive. If they make you feel positive, great, keep it. But if there's a single percentage of negativity in terms of the material aspect or anything that they're doing that doesn't align with you, unfollow. I've recently switched to a creator, not a consumer. So I just create. I create from the heart. I create from the soul. I create from what I read. I create from what I believe in, and I no longer consume. When I was consuming for 8 years, I struggled a lot. My relationships, my love, my finance, everything was struggling. And when I took out social media, again, there's other tools, as you can tell, we're on day 7 now. Other tools have helped along this journey, but social media has been a pinnacle. I ended up deleting social media for 365 days. I did a detox. I did a pact to myself. I said, okay, for the next year, no social media. I delete everything. And that is when everything switched. That brought me here today with the confidence and the excitement to be a creator, all because I deleted it 2-3 years ago. And again, I made a video about this. Go check out that video. I go deep into that story and I share all the tips and all that stuff. So anyways, let's hop over to the bonus. I hope this brought you benefit. I hope this brought you value these 7 days. The bonus is going to be, it's just like a little sweetener on the top. It's just like, okay, cool. You got these 7 days, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You do this for 365 days, your entire life will change. Everything will change. Your mind will change. Everything will change. And the 7th one is just like that extra dopamine release, that extra serotonin release, that extra chemical release. Let's hop into it. So the 7 days were intense in terms of, you know, adding that, changing it. Maybe you're already doing all 7 of them, which is amazing. Maybe you're doing a couple of them. Maybe you're doing 1 of the 7. Regardless, adding these will change everything. Now the bonus is a classic. I'm sure you can connect the dots by now. It is getting outside. It is exercising. This could be yoga. This could be going to the gym. This could be running, walking, getting your 10,000 steps in, Tai Chi, any kind of practice that gets you connected to the body, the mind, and get it moving. Get the body moving. And there are so many benefits to this. The reason I put it as a bonus, because it's a bonus to be able to do this with our bodies. It is to be able to do the first 7, that's the root, but to be able to do this, it naturally releases all those endorphins, the dopamine, the serotonin. It naturally releases it. And it's like a hack to be able to naturally release those endorphins. So get outside, get moving. And I just want to say congrats for getting this far, for doing all this. Like, your body, your mind, your soul will thank you in the future. Your future kid, your future partner, everybody, including yourself, will thank you. You're making an imprint, you're becoming a better person by just
putting yourself first and focusing on you. And this will help you create the life you want, to build the dream you want, to build everything that aligns with you. And anyways, keep me posted. Let me know how this journey was. Let me know which day was the easiest, what day was the hardest. Let me know if any of it makes sense. Let me know if it doesn't make sense. Keep me posted. I'm here for the growth. I love it. And I'm passionate about this. And it's from the heart. Anyways, much love. We'll talk soon. Adios.